Good morning, dear students. Today we are starting a new topic, Spina Bifida. You can see in the figure, a child is sitting and there is something bulging on the spine, from the spine, posteriorly from the spine of the child. And this condition is actually affecting the spinal cord, which we call as neural tube. So neural tube defects are largest group of congenital anomalies. If you are taking congenital anomalies, neural tube defects are the largest group. Failure of neural tube to close produces defects of either entire neural tube or small areas. Etiology. Anencephaly and spina bifida occur together very often. So when we study spina bifida, most commonly hydrocephalus as well as spina bifida, it occurs. That is some kind of, you know, anomaly of the head also is common, such as even Arnold Chiari malformation, which I have mentioned in the hydrocephalus, always comes along with the spina bifida. And spina bifida is seen in the gender base. If you see, females are more susceptible. Female children are more susceptible than males. 50% occur due to nutritional deficiency, mainly due to folic acid deficiency. You can see the figures given. In this figure, you can see the vertebral bodies. This is the anterior part and this is the posterior part. We can see the spinous process. Actually, this is a cross section. And here you can see that there is a loss of spinous process in this the lower lumbar area. You can see that it is absent. So lumbosacral area, it is absent. So this one is a mildest form. We called it as spina bifida occulta. Here you can see that the neural tube, the spinal cord is intact. The meninges is also intact. You can see the meninges covering layer thecal sac. You can see it is intact. Only thing is it's only the bony closure of the posterior part of the vertebral column is absent. In the second severest form, you can see that the whole posterior spine is bulging out like a cyst, which filled with CSF, and the meninges is protruding outside, and you can see some part of the cauda equina as well as the peripheral nerve is also protruding to the cyst. This is called as meningocele. Because here the meninges are involved, we are calling it as meningocele. Here the severest form of spina bifida, myelomeningocele. Myel means spinal cord. So myel as well as meninges together. You can see the whole spinal cord deviated outside. And you can see that there is no bony closure whatsoever. And also there is no meninges covering also here. So some patient may have some meninges covering. Here we are shown a very severe case because the cauda equina is just subcutaneous. So any contact here may, you know, elicit a lot of sensory stimulation. So spina bifida occulta. Spina bifida defined as midline defects involving failure of the bony spine to close. It is a midline defect involving failure of the bony spine to close in spina bifida. Spina bifida occulta defect not visible externally occurs most often in lumbosacral area. Most often it occurs in lumbosacral area, not apparent unless there are gait disturbances. So usually somebody who has spina bifida occulta, they will never know in their life unless they have some gait disturbances, foot deformities, or bladder, incontinence, bladder or bowel incontinence, or other neuromuscular manifestations. Many people with occulta will never have any deficits and may not know they have it. In the second severest form, meningocele, where the meninges is affected, sac-like cyst that protrudes outside the spine. Spina bifida occulta and meningocele usually do not present with neurological deficits. However, Bladder and bowel incontinence may be present depending on the level of the lesion. You have to understand, my dear student, that the level, this neural tube defect can happen in any level of the spinal cord, but usually it happens in the lumbar sacral area. And you already must be thinking that according to the level, if when it is higher level, severity will be higher because much of the upper limb, if it is in the cervical level, just imagine all the brachial plexus and everything below also will be affected. Myelomeningocele produces more severe impairments, obviously. Flaccid or spastic paralysis, bladder incontinence, musculoskeletal deformities such as scoliosis, hip dysplasia, hip dislocation, club foot, hip bar knee contracture, hydrocephalus, along with type 1 and type 2 Arnold-Chiari malformation, trunk hypotonia, delayed automatic postural reactions. See, very so severe impairments are happening. Flaccid or either flaccid or either spastic paralysis, bladder incontinence, sometimes bowel incontinence, musculoskeletal deformities such as scoliosis, hip dysplasia, hip dislocation, club foot, which we call as congenital talipes equinovarus deformity, hip knee, that is flexor contractures, hydrocephalus along with type 1 or type 2 Arnold-Chiari malformation, hypotonia, generalized hypotonia of the trunk, delayed automatic postural reactions. Other morbidities, coexisting comorbidities are osteopenia or osteoporosis, means reduced calcium level, demineralization of calcium due to the decreased level of activities of many of these individuals. This will ultimately cause a decrease in bone density that will put them at risk for fractures. Obesity is common because activity is reduced. Decreased activity of the person leads to sedentary lifestyle and naturally obesity may occur. Again, you can see that in myelomeningocele, the whole spinal cord is coming out. Here you can see that the spinal cord is a blue colored, which is intact. Only the meninges, which is a red color, is coming out. See how it looks. This is a myelomeningocele, very severe condition. The whole spinal cord is protruding out from the back of the lower back of the lumbar sacral area of the child. See another child lying down, very neonate, maybe 2 months, just infant of 2 months old. See the size of the big, huge area is affected from the lumbar sacral till to the thoracic area. The whole peripheral nerve affects, and also you can see that the muscular weakness will develop, and they, when the child grows, the severe deformity will be there. So here you can see, which is normal, the body is normal, the spinous processes are normal, and the spinal cord is normal in picture A. Picture B, there is nothing much abnormality in the anterior as well as the spinal cord, but posteriorly you can see some tuft of hair in the skin and loss of closure of the posterior vertebral column. So that will give instability for the lumbar spine. Back pain may come in, you know, when the person grows. Here you can see a lack of closure of the spinous process. Along with that, you can see the meninges protruding outside. Here, severest form, myelomeningocele, the whole mile, the spinal cord is protruding outside along with the meninges. In the X-ray, you can see here there is a closure, right? The posterior part of where we see the spinous process. Here, see, there is a defective. It's not closed. Myelomeningocele, otherwise called as spina bifida, develops during first 28 days of pregnancy when neural tube fails to close and fuse. It develops beginning from first 28 days of the pregnancy when neural tube fails to close and fuse. 90% of spinal cord lesions and may occur at any point along spine. Any point at spine can happen, but mostly seen in the lumbosacral area. Sac usually enclosed in fine membrane that is prone to tear. See, the child cannot sleep on that back, so it may tear. So it very going to be very complicated then. Largest number in lumbar or lumbosacral area. 90 to 95% of the children have hydrocephalus. So hydrocephalus, whenever you see some any patient in future with hydrocephalus, don't forget to inspect the spine. Check the whole back part. Then only you will see that if it is there is spina bifida, management is going to be, you have to take special precautions. Careful monitoring of head size important. Along with that, usually hydrocephalus with meningomyelocele means very severe. Surely type 1 or type 2 Arnold-Chiari malformation may be present. So observe for the infant for stridor, hoarse cry from vocal, that is due to vocal cord paralysis, feeding difficulties normally because of the brainstem is affected. In hydrocephalus and Arnold-Chiari malformation, the whole brainstem is, herniating to the through the foramen magnum. So deteriorating upper extremity, the brachial plexus is also affected. So observe for the stridor, that is breathing quality is worsening, hoarse cry means very rough cry, hoarse sound from vocal cord paralysis, feeding difficulty due to glossopharyngeal nerve is affected, the gag is affected, deteriorating upper extremity function due to brachial plexus involvement. Clinical manifestations, signs and symptoms vary according to degree of spinal defect. So here the degree of defect, first we have to diagnose, then we only will understand about the signs and symptoms. Readily apparent on inspection, within few seconds you just undress the child and see, you will find out. Loss of sensation below lesion, poor urinary and bladder control, joint deformities in lower extremity. Usually whenever it is in lumbosacral, the lumbar plexus will be affected. Normally the whole lower limb is going to be affected either with spastic or flaccid according to the involvement. Scoliosis or kyphosis, that is the orthopedic deformity which we are getting, musculoskeletal deformity, hip dislocation due to hip dysplasia. The hip dysplasia already we have mentioned, so that will lead to hip dislocation. So diagnostic evaluation, examination of meningeal sac, clinical manifestation, normally X-ray, MRI, computer tomography, CT scan to assess condition of the brain and the spinal. So X-ray you can only see the bony closure is affected, abnormal loss of bony closure posteriorly. MRI and CT scan to assess condition of the brain and spinal cord, other defects may be also be present. Prenatal fetal ultrasound. So usually we understood that the from the 28th day of gestation, conception, the defect may develop. So that means that the first trimester, whenever the mother, the pregnant mother goes to the for monitoring fetal ultrasound or amniotic fluid sample for alpha fetal protein. So alpha fetal protein is a fetal protein which will be diagnostic in understanding that the child has some kind of defect such as hydrocephalus or even mainly the spina bifida. Test should be done between 16 to 18 weeks of gestation. Afterwards AFP level drops. So here within the 16 to 18 weeks the test has to be done. Normal complete delivery happens in 38 weeks. So here we are talking about somewhere this is between the half of the second to third month. So before the third month is of conception is the best time to check alpha fetal protein. AFP is alpha fetal protein. Afterwards AFP level may drop, making detection of spina bifida difficult. Also therapeutic abortion not option after this time. So therapeutically doing an abortion to understand that the fetus is going to have a anomaly, but still we cannot do the abortion, is going to be very very dangerous for the mother also. See how they do the, they take the amniotic fluid for alpha fetal protein analysis. They put an injection directly and take